Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our 9th session on analog circuits, module 5. In this session, we'll be learning about the 555 timer. We'll understand the working of the 555 timer and the internal block diagram of the 555 timer, how it is constructed internally. And we'll also try to analyze and design a simple application of 555 timer, that is the monostable multivibrator. This 555 timer is a very highly versatile IC, and it was manufactured by the Signetics Corporation in the year 1971. And because of its versatility and usage, they found so much usage for this IC that it was known as the IC time machine. And it was the very first and only commercial IC timer available. So it became very popular in almost all applications. And the main usage of this 555 timer, as the name indicates, you can understand from the name itself, it is to generate fixed timing delays. You can generate fixed timing delays of any value. In the sense, I can generate timing delays in microseconds, milliseconds, or even hours, minutes or hours. And it provided circuit designers and hobby tinkerers a relatively cheap, stable, user-friendly, and easy to use integrated circuit for monostable as well as astable applications. We'll discuss about those applications as we proceed. First, let's try to understand this 555 timer IC. Let's try to see its pinout diagram. It is basically an 8-pin IC, as you can see here. And all those 8 pins are used for different purposes. As you can see the naming, pin 1 is ground, pin 8 is VCC. Pin 2 is the trigger input, where we are going to connect an external trigger. So that the output can be changing states. If we want the output to change from one state to another, usually it is done with the help of an external trigger input. That trigger input can be in the form of a square wave, or it can be in the form of pulses or anything like that. I can even give impulses like this. I can even try to give impulse trigger or pulses of small width, trigger pulses of small width. And pin 3 is the pin where we are going to check the output. The output will be available at pin 3. Pin 4 is called the reset pin. In the sense, if the output of the timer, say the output of the timer was designed for 10 minutes or so, and due to some reason, I want the timing to get to zero after 6 minutes or 7 minutes. Say after 7 minutes, I want the timer output to come to zero, but you have initially designed the circuit so that it will stay high for 10 minutes. So if we want to bring the output to zero in between its timing cycle, you have designed a timing cycle of 10 minutes. And in between the timing cycle, if you want to bring the timer output to zero, you will make use of this reset pin. So if you give a zero, or if you connect this reset pin to ground, it can reset the output back to zero state. The output which is in high state will be brought back to zero state if we connect reset to zero. And if I don't want to do that reset, if I don't want to reset in between the timing cycle, we will normally keep this reset pin at plus VCC. So generally, it is kept at plus VCC when we don't want to make use of the reset pin. Otherwise, it will be brought to zero. Pin 5 is called the control voltage pin. The main usage of this pin is we can connect an external voltage which will superimpose on an existing internal voltage. So at pin 5, there will already be an existing internal voltage which is equal to 2/3 of VCC. So this is the existing voltage which is already present at pin 5. As I will show you, you can see this control voltage pin will help us connect an external voltage that will superimpose on this existing DC voltage so that the control voltage which is applied can be changed. We will use this in few applications like the pulse width modulation circuit or so on. So there I'll be giving an external sine wave at this pin, and that will superimpose on the existing 2/3 VCC, and it will help modulate the width of the output pulse. So whenever I want to change the width of the output pulse, I don't want the output pulse width to remain fixed always. Then I'm going to give an external voltage on this control pin. And if I don't use it, when it is not used, what are we going to do? We will connect one capacitor from pin 5 to ground, and the value of that capacitor is 0.01 microfarad. So this is mainly to avoid transitions due to noise. So this is mainly to minimize the noise or false transitions because of noise in the timer. Coming to pin 6, it is called threshold pin. And as the name indicates, it will be used as a threshold value. So if I give some external voltage at that pin, and that voltage will act as a threshold for comparison. And if it is less than that voltage, output will be at some voltage, some logic high. And if when it crosses that level, it will become logic zero, something like that. So this, at this point, we are going to connect external capacitor and resistors to supply the voltage where I want the threshold to be, or it is used for comparison with the internally generated voltage. I will show you all that. Pin 7 is called the discharge pin. There is a transistor connected at this pin. And whenever the external capacitor which is charged has to discharge, usually it is going to be connected to pin 7. It will happen through this discharge transistor which is going to be present at pin 7. So these are the various pins, and here we are showing an 8-pin T package, the round one. There can be a metal can put on top of that also if you want to avoid heat or something. And this is a 8-pin V package, or it's also called something similar to dual inline package, DIP package. You have normally seen ICs which you used in the lab are this dual inline package. In the sense, there will be two layers of silicon and sandwiched from the center, we are going to have the pins. The IC will be present in between two layers of silicon, and the central part, from there the pinouts will be coming. So what is inside the 555 timer? What do you see inside the 555 timer? The first and most important thing, you'll see a potential divider network of 3.5 kilo ohm resistor connected between pin 8 and pin 1. Pin 8 is VCC, as we discussed. Pin 1 is the ground for this IC. So a group of 3.5 kilo ohm resistor connected in series between VCC and ground is the potential divider. And this is a reason why this 555 may be called by its name. The reason why this timer was named as 555 may be because of this 3.5K resistors, which are present internally, and they are connected between pin 8 and 1, where pin 8 would be the VCC or power supply and pin 1 would be the ground. And what is the amount of power supply which you can apply to this 555 timer? Usually it varies between 5 to 18 volts. You can give a DC power supply anywhere between 5 to 18 volts in a 555 timer. Then coming to the two other important components of the 555 timer, the two comparators. Hope you all remember what happens in a comparator. A comparator will compare the voltages at its two input terminals and it will generate the output which will either be at positive saturation or negative saturation. This is an op amp which doesn't have a feedback. It is normally op amp in open loop mode without any feedback, acts like a comparator. So if at all the voltage at the non-inverting terminal is greater than voltage at inverting terminal, whenever V1 is greater than V2, voltage at the non-inverting more than voltage at the inverting, output will be at positive saturation. Positive terminal voltage is higher than the negative terminal, so output is at plus Vsat. And whenever V1 is less than V2, that is the negative terminal voltage V2 is higher than V1, then output will remain at minus Vsat. I can consider plus Vsat as logic 1 and minus Vsat as logic 0. And if we want, we can even reduce the voltages from the levels of plus Vsat and minus Vsat can be controlled by what power supplies we are going to give to these op-amp comparators. So this first comparator is also called as lower comparator, and the second one is called the upper comparator. So if I just tilt this IC to the left, rotate it to the left, you will see the upper one will be 2 and the lower one will be comparator 1. And let's observe what are the inputs coming to these comparators. To the comparator 1, also called lower comparator, one input to the inverting terminal is coming from pin 2, which would be the external trigger voltage which we are going to apply. So if you connect an external signal generator there, you will be giving a pulse signal or a square wave there. And that will be coming to the inverting terminal of this comparator. And what comes to the non-inverting terminal? To the non-inverting terminal, you see, we have the output after the lowest 5K resistor being connected. So if it's something like this, the connection is something like this. You have 3 5K resistors and this end is VCC. So it is like connecting VCC across this 3 5K resistors, right? So this is how it works. And this resistor, if I'm going to measure the output across this resistor alone, how much will it be? It will be 5 by 15, 5 divided by 5 plus 5 plus 5 into VCC, or in other words, it will be 1/3 of VCC. So can you see the voltage at this terminal after the lowest 5K resistor in the potential divider? It's the voltage across this 5K resistor. It will be 1/3 of VCC. And that fixed value comes as input to the non-inverting terminal of the lower comparator, as you can see. And to the inverting terminal, we are going to connect an external trigger input. Now, please understand, whenever the external trigger value becomes less than 1/3 VCC, the output of this comparator will be high. So when will the output of this comparator be high? Whenever 1/3 VCC is greater than the external trigger input. External trigger is given to inverting terminal. So whenever the non-inverting terminal voltage is higher, you can clearly expect the output will be at logic 1 or plus Vsat. And if the inverting terminal voltage is higher than 1/3 VCC, it will be at minus Vsat or 0. So that's the basic behavior of the comparator, which we know. Now, let's move on to this upper comparator. What happens? What are the voltages to compare in the upper comparator? The inverting terminal of the upper comparator is connected to the second 5K resistor, as you can see. So this point, what would be the voltage from this point to ground? After 2 5K resistors, the voltage will be 10 by 15 into VCC, or in other words, it would turn out to be how much? 2/3 of VCC. So since the total voltage here is VCC, after 2 5K resistors, or the total voltage across this would be 5K plus 5K, that is 10K divided by 15K into VCC. So we are going to have 2/3 of VCC at this point. And next, what is there connected to the non-inverting terminal of the upper comparator? As I told you, it is the threshold pin. And here, usually we are going to connect an external capacitor and resistor connection. So you may have a resistance connected to the VCC, this VCC here, okay? And you are going to have the capacitor. So this type of capacitor would be connected to pin 6 as the threshold input. So whatever is the voltage drop VC across that external capacitor, that will be appearing as the input to the non-inverting terminal of this comparator. And as discussed before, what would happen? If this VC is greater than 2/3 VCC, output of this comparator will be logic 1. If this VC capacitor voltage is less than 2/3 VCC, output of this comparator would be 0. So these are the two basic elements, along with the 3 5K resistor potential divider, which is present within the 555 timer IC. Now, coming to what happens to the output of these comparators. You see, we are generating logic high or logic zero as output of these comparators, and that will be taken as input to the SR flip-flop. You see, we are using an SR flip-flop in this circuit, and the S input comes from the lower comparator and the R input comes from the upper comparator. And we know how an SR flip-flop works. We'll write the truth table of the SR flip-flop a little later. And the Q output is not considered, but Q bar output, as you can observe here, is taken as the final output of the flip-flop. I'm not using the direct output Q, but I'm using the complemented output Q bar as the output of the flip-flop. And even that is not directly going to the output pin or pin 3. You can see Q bar is connected through an output driver or power amplifier. We call this output driver also as a power amplifier. And when we amplify power, it will also invert the signal. So I can say this is power amplifier plus inverter. Remember why? We normally use common emitter or common source amplifier stages because they are the only stages which will provide both voltage and current, that is power amplification. So in power amplification, normally we need both voltage and current amplification, and that is possible using either common emitter or common source in BJT or FET depending on the situation. So these amplifiers, we know, will always provide 180 degree phase shift between the output and the input terminals. That's why this inversion. So whenever I make use of an output driver or power amplifier, there is always going to be an inversion in the signal. So if you feed Q bar as input to this, the final output would be same as Q. It will be Q double bar, which will turn out to be Q. So this is where you see the final output. The final output will be in the form of a rectangular wave, which will be alternating between ones and zeros, or high and low. Next, coming to pin 4, you can see pin 4 is connected to the reset input of the flip-flop. So there are two ways in which this can be connected. This is one of them. The other one I'll show in another block diagram. So you can see that pin 4 is directly given to the complemented reset input. So what does it tell? The output of the flip-flop will be reset to zero whenever this reset input is low. So whenever you give a zero at this reset input, actually it is reset bar. So whenever you give a zero here, the output of this flip-flop Q will become zero. Okay. This is about the reset pin. As I have already explained, it is to bring the output to zero in between the timing cycle. Without it finishing timing cycle, we want to bring the output to zero somewhere in between. Then it is possible by doing this reset pin, bringing it down to zero or connecting it to the ground. So pin 5, the control voltage pin, you see, as I told you, it is superimposed. It is connected to this point, the inverting terminal of the upper comparator. What do I have here already? I already have a voltage 2/3 VCC coming because of this potential divider terminal connected to this inverting terminal of the upper comparator. On top of that, we are going to connect an external control voltage by using an external signal generator also. So whatever external voltage you give, say I already have 2/3 VCC, I'm going to connect a sine wave. That sine wave, if I connect externally here, if I'm going to use a sine wave, that sine wave will superimpose on this 2/3 VCC, and you will see the voltage at this inverting pin varying with 2/3 VCC plus the signal or minus the signal depending on the variation. How the signal is. So if the signal is a sine wave, when it goes in positive half cycle, the voltage 2/3 VCC gets added to that sine wave. And when the sine wave is in negative half cycle, 2/3 VCC will get subtracted, or the sine wave gets subtracted from 2/3 VCC to generate varying comparison voltage at the inverting pin of upper comparator. And what else is left here? Yeah, that's it. So this is about the internal construction. We have one more element, that is this transistor. Can you see this NPN transistor here? This transistor, if you see, is of NPN type, and its emitter is being connected to pin 1 or the ground, and the collector has been connected to pin 7, which is also named as the discharge pin. So what happens here? If I am going to connect this capacitor, which I have connected at pin 6, to pin 7 also, whenever this capacitor voltage is high and it has already charged to the complete possible value, we need the capacitor to discharge. So how does the capacitor discharge? It will discharge easily through this pin 7 whenever this transistor is turned on. And how will this transistor be turned on? You see, the base of this transistor is connected to the output Q bar of the flip-flop. So what's going to happen here? If Q bar is a 1, then sufficient forward bias base emitter voltage is available for this transistor to switch on. And whenever a transistor is on, remember, it's like there is a virtual short between the collector and emitter terminals. And it is going to bypass all the voltages which is present at pin 7 to the ground. So there will be a sudden increase in current through that transistor, sending all the voltages across that external capacitor to the ground. Okay. And otherwise, if this base is at zero, if the base of this NPN transistor is at zero when Q bar, the output of the flip-flop, is zero, then this transistor is in off state, and when it is in off state, it will allow this external timing capacitor to charge. Whenever this transistor is in on state, it will make the external timing capacitor to discharge. That's why this collector of the transistor that's connected to pin 7 is known as the discharge pin. Okay, and this is called the discharge transistor. Hope it's clear what is present internal the 555 timer IC. Next, we'll show the same block diagram without any changes. We have just, as I was telling you, rotate the previous diagram left by 90 degrees. You will see this. Between pin 8 and pin 1, you have this potential divider of 3 5K resistors. All these are compulsorily 5K resistors. Then you have a lower comparator, upper comparator. The non-inverting input to the lower comparator is 1/3 VCC. The inverting input to upper comparator is 2/3 VCC because it's measured across that potential divider of the resistors. And external trigger input can be given to the inverting terminal of lower comparator and the threshold input, which will be an external capacitor resistor combination, will be given at pin 6. Outputs of the comparators are going to the SR flip-flop, and you see Q is not used. The output Q of the SR flip-flop is not used, but Q bar. The simple reason why Q bar is used is because we use an output stage which has power amplifier plus inverter. So we know that whatever output we get here is inverted again. So whatever Q bar you get here, it becomes Q, which is same as this value. So if I had considered Q as the output of the flip-flop, it would have got inverted and I would have got Q bar. So it's better to consider Q bar itself when we anyhow in flip-flops, what complementary outputs are available. Okay, so you can consider this and get. And as usual, the discharge transistor whose collector is at pin 7 and the base of the discharge transistor is connected to the output of the flip-flop. If this Q bar is 1, the transistor is on. If this is off, if this is 0, then the transistor will be off. Whenever the transistor is on, it will send all the charges to the ground. And whenever the transistor is off, it will make the external capacitor to charge or retain all the charges. So it's the same diagram. The pin 4 or reset input is connected to the RST pin of the flip-flop. Now, let's see. The same thing is shown here in the diagram. This is your output stage, which is power amplifier plus inverter. So as you can see, an inverter diagram is shown there. Now, coming to the truth table of the SR flip-flop. Remember, in an SR flip-flop, if both the inputs are zeros, the output will remain in its previous state. So Q and Q bar, the outputs will remain in their previous states if both S and R are zero. Okay. And this is also known as the no change state because output will continue to remain in whatever previous state it was. The next set of inputs are when the set input S is 0 and reset is 1. So when S is 0 and reset is 1, Q will remain 0. Whenever the set input is 0, Q becomes 0 and Q bar becomes 1. Okay, so please remember, whenever S is the lower comparator connection, R is the upper comparator connection. So whenever this S becomes 0 and R is high, Q is 0, Q bar is 1. This is called the reset state of the SR flip-flop. Similarly, whenever S becomes 1 and R becomes 0, set state of the flip-flop and the output will be at logic high. Q will be at high. Since we are making use of Q bar, it will be at 0. After inversion, again, you'll get high. And finally, remember, you have one more unused or state which is forbidden. That is 1-1. So in an SR flip-flop, we can never use both set and reset inputs to be high simultaneously, because the flip-flop won't know whether it should go to set state or reset state. Okay, so there will always be confusion. Hence, both inputs being 1-1 results in a forbidden state which is not allowed. So please remember, you can never have both values R and S to become 1-1 in your application circuit. So we are going to design the multivibrator applications next. It should be taken care that both S and R becoming continuously 1 should be avoided. Okay. It's the same block diagram. Yeah, one change is there. That is use of transistor T2, which is also called as the reset transistor. Some of the textbooks will show this reset transistor to be used in place of the reset button, which is connected to the SR flip-flop. And this is an older version anyway. Now it is usually the reset button itself. What happens here? You can see that the emitter of this transistor is connected to a positive reference voltage, and the collector is connected to the output of the SR flip-flop, which comes as input to the power amplifier or the output stage. So this is the output stage or the power amplifier. So you can see what happens here. You see it is a PNP transistor. This is a PNP transistor. So how does it switch on? Only when the base is at zero potential when compared to the emitter. In a PNP transistor, please remember the emitter is always at higher potential than the base. In that case, if you have connected emitter to a higher potential, this is P, this is N, and this is P. Now, the base emitter junction will be what? It would be forward biased. N is at a lower potential when connected, emitter P is at plus Vref. So now this transistor will be on. Remember, if you connect pin 4 to 0 or ground, whenever you connect pin 4 to 0 or ground, the PN junction of this transistor will get forward biased because the P or the emitter terminal is already at a positive reference voltage. And whenever it becomes forward biased, this transistor is on. And what happens when this transistor is on? It's like there is a virtual short between the collector and emitter terminals of this transistor. And all the current flowing because of Vref will flow through this transistor, and it will come and override the voltage which is present. So if I had a zero here, this Vref will send a current. So Vref will be present instead of zero. So zero will get changed to Vref. Vref means it is logic one. And what would happen? If you have a logic one here, the final output would go to logic zero. So what is the purpose served by this transistor? Whenever the output was high, it is going to bring the output to zero because of the action of this transistor T2. Remember, transistor T2 is optional. It can be used in place of the reset button of the or the reset pin of the flip-flop. Otherwise, we can simply make use of the reset pin and we can leave out the use of this transistor. Okay, so this is one of the versions of the internal construction of the 555. We use a PNP transistor in place of the reset pin of the SR flip-flop. Okay, so the definition of the pins is mentioned here. I have already defined all the pins, so I'll just skip through this. You can read the 555 timer basic operation. Let's see. So we have the 555 diagram, internal block diagram. As you can see, this is the upper comparator. This is the lower comparator. The non-inverting input is shown down and the inverting input is shown up. And the discharge transistor, pin 4, the reset pin, pin 8, the power supply, pin 3, the final output, which is connected to the Q bar of the flip-flop. So what happens here? The first action is in the voltage divider, the voltage VCC, which we give at pin 8, gets divided into three equal parts. I'm going to have VCC by 3 here, VCC by 3 here, and how much will I have here? I will have 2 by 3 VCC here. So the total voltage which is applied, VCC, across the potential divider is split into three parts across each of the 5K resistors, and the values 1/3 VCC comes to the lower comparator non-inverting terminal, and the value 2/3 VCC comes to the upper comparator inverting terminal. Next are the two comparators and how they behave. Then you have the discharge transistor here, which will help to discharge an external device to the ground, like an external capacitor. And threshold pin, pin 6, trigger pin, pin 2, control voltage, pin 5, output pin, pin 3. And you see the output goes through a power amplifier plus inverter here. And the reset pin, pin 4, which is connected to the reset bar input of the flip-flop, SR flip-flop. So what will happen as the result of comparison? You see, let me consider the voltage at pin 6 as V6 and the voltage at pin 5 as VA. This voltage is fixed at 2/3 VCC. This V6 will vary depending on what external voltage you're going to connect here, the capacitor voltage. And we'll call the input trigger, which is applied to pin 2, as V2. And the voltage that is fixed, that is how much? VCC by 3. The non-inverting terminal of this comparator has, this is lower comparator, this is upper comparator. Please keep remembering all these things. And the S output is connected from the lower comparator. The R of the flip-flop comes from the upper comparator. So let's see what happens with different comparison levels. So the first case is, if this V6 is less than 2/3 VCC. So if I have this less than 2/3 VCC, whereas VA or V5 is more than 2/3 VCC. So what happens to the output of this upper comparator? The non-inverting terminal voltage is less than the inverting terminal voltage. Hence, the output of this comparator C1 will be 0. Whenever non-inverting, just remember, this goes to the non-inverting terminal, and here V2 is in the second comparator. V2 goes to the inverting terminal. So if you remember these things, it would be very helpful. You can clearly see whenever V6 becomes less than 2/3 VCC, whereas VA remains at 2/3 VCC, output of this comparator will be 0. And similarly for V2, V2 is the external trigger input, which is coming to the lower comparator. And this voltage V2 gets compared with the voltage, fixed voltage VCC by 3. So what you can see here, if V2 is less than 1/3 VCC, whereas VB is at VCC by 3 or 1/3 VCC, whereas V2 becomes less, inverting terminal voltage is less than non-inverting terminal voltage. Hence, the set pin becomes high. Okay, as simple as this. Similarly, if V6 is greater than 2/3 VCC, then output of this comparator would be 1. whenever V6 is greater than 2/3 VCC, because inverting terminal is at 2/3 VCC. What happens? R becomes high, as you can see here. Similarly, what will happen to S whenever V2 becomes more than 1/3 VCC? If V2 becomes more than 1/3 VCC, what would happen at the lower comparator? V2 is inverting terminal input and it is more than the non-inverting. So this goes to zero. Here, the value of R goes from 0 to 1 in the second case. Here, the value of S goes from 1 to 0 in the second case. So you see the values of R and S will be in this state. This is your reset state and this is the set state. Whenever set input is high, the SR flip-flop is in set state. Output will be high, Q bar will be 0. Whenever R is 1 and S is 0, the output of the flip-flop will be in reset or the 0 state. And then there is this condition. If V6 is less than 2/3 VCC, which means R will be 0, and V2 is more than 1/3 VCC. V2, the external trigger input, becomes higher than 1/3 VCC. In that case, you are getting both outputs of the comparators as 0, 0. And this is the what? Same as the previous state or the no repeat state. Previously, the output may have remained at 0. Hence, now also it will remain. And finally, coming to the last state, the forbidden state. We know in forbidden state, the outputs of both comparators will become 1. When will output of upper comparator become 1? Whenever V6 is greater than 2/3 VCC. So whenever V6 is higher than 2/3 VCC, then output of upper comparator will be high. Yes or no? Non-inverting terminal input is more than inverting, so this turns to high. Similarly, when the non-inverting terminal voltage, that is your VB, becomes more than V2, which is 1/3 VCC. VB is 1/3 VCC. V2 is the external trigger. Whenever V2 becomes less than 1/3 VCC, then output of this comparator is also high. Hence, you'll get the forbidden state, which hasn't been used, which can't be used. It's not permitted. So, depending on what happens to the final output at pin 3 and the Q and Q bar, Q1 here stands for the transistor. When the transistor is on and off, Q is the output of the flip-flop. We are actually interested in Q bar. This output Q would be the final output after power amplifier and inversion also. So if the set input is high and reset is 0, Q should be set state and Q bar will be in 0 state. And what happens to the transistor? Remember, this output is connected to the discharge transistor. You see, the output of this flip-flop, Q bar, is connected as base to the discharge transistor. If the voltage at the base is high, then the transistor is on. And if the voltage at the base is low, the transistor is off. That's what we were trying to tell here. So Q1 represents the transistor. It is on whenever Q is high and Q bar is here. This Q bar is high, then Q1 will be on. If Q is high and Q bar will be low, this will be off. Remember, whenever Q bar is high, transistor Q1 is on. In this case, the transistor is on, and whenever Q is high and Q bar is low, the transistor will be off. A 1 here makes the transistor on, and a 0 here makes it off. Remember that. Okay. And if at all it comes, R and S both comes to the 0-0 state, it is the previous state output, same as in the previous state. And this is about the working of the final output and the transistor along with the SR flip-flop. The conditions which we already discussed, similar conditions. Here we have just included Q and Q bar and Q1, the final output. Yeah, here it's written correctly. This is off. It is on here. Okay, with this, next, let's discuss one of the simplest applications of the 555 timer, that is the monostable multivibrator, and the next one is astable multivibrator. So we can discuss about these applications. What is a multivibrator? A multivibrator is some circuit which will generate output which exists in more than one state. So remember this, whenever the output exists in more than one state, then we say it is a multivibrator, because the output goes on shifting, vibrating between two states, then it is a multi-state vibrator or a multivibrator. And we have three classifications of multivibrators, three types that are possible. One is the astable, then monostable, and bistable. Astable multivibrator is also called a free-running multivibrator, which has no stable states. Please remember, it will be asked in Viva also in the lab. You'll be doing these astable and monostable in the lab, right? Or you have already done. It is astable multivibrator is a circuit which has no stable states, but it is surely going to have two states, and it will be switching continuously between those two states. It will always have a high and a low state, and the output keeps shifting between low and high continuously, depending upon the R and C values which we are going to connect in the external circuit. Next comes the monostable. It's also called as the one-shot multivibrator. You look at the nicknames, the astable is called free-running multivibrator because it is going to freely generate rectangular or square wave-like pulses. This also acts like an oscillator, astable multivibrator. Doesn't need an external input or trigger input. Hence, it is going to generate a square wave or rectangular wave oscillation. Hence, it is known as an oscillator or a free-running multivibrator. Whereas the monostable is called the one-shot multivibrator because it has one stable state and another quasi or semi-stable states. The states which are not stable are called the quasi-stable states or semi-stable states. And how do you know which state is stable and which state is not stable? Say you have the signal like this. How do I know whether this 0 is stable or 1 is stable? It's a very simple analysis. The output will continue to remain in the stable state unless and until you're going to apply an external trigger input to make the output to change its state. Say, for example, I'll consider the stable state of the monostable multivibrator as state 0. Okay, so this is the stable state, and it will continuously remain in this stable state without changing its state if the trigger input is not applied. Only when this trigger input is applied, the output changes from stable to quasi-stable. we call this as quasi or semi-stable state. And now you should ask me why this is called semi-stable or quasi-stable. And I told you why this is called stable, because output will remain in that state if you don't apply an external trigger to make it change its state. Now coming to the reason why this state is the quasi or semi-stable, because output will not wait for an external trigger. It will automatically come back to its stable state based on an RC circuit which you are going to connect externally. So based on a timing circuit or an RC circuit which you will connect externally, output will simply change from quasi to stable state. And that's why this state is called semi-stable or quasi-stable. So output will remain constant for various conditions. But once that timing cycle has elapsed, the RC values which are used to determine the timing, once that is elapsed, you will see the output automatically comes back from its quasi-stable state to the stable state. Okay. So what is the understanding here? When the state changes only after applying an external trigger, then that is called a stable state. So if you have to change from a stable state by applying an external trigger, then it is a stable state. Whereas if the output changes on its own without an external trigger, you have some external circuitry connected, but no trigger voltage. So without giving external trigger, if the output changes on its own, then it is a quasi-stable state. Okay. So a monostable multivibrator has one stable state and one quasi-stable state, whereas a stable multivibrator has two quasi-stable state or no stable states at all. So please remember, a stable multivibrator doesn't have any stable state, but it still has two states. Both of them are semi or quasi-stable. And then we have a bistable multivibrator. The best example is a flip-flop. It is going to have two stable states. In monostable, it is one. In bistable, it is two stable states. So can you tell me what will happen here now? You can easily guess what will happen here. Here, the output has to change from one stable state to another. You need to give an external trigger input for it to change from zero state to one state, and both are stable, remember. And output will continue to remain in one state if I don't give another external trigger to make this output change back to zero state. So only when you apply external trigger voltages, the output can change states. And this happens in a bistable multivibrator. So the best example is a flip-flop. I think the same thing is explained here. A stable multivibrator doesn't need an external trigger, no trigger input. So no need of external trigger input in A stable, whereas it still generates a square or rectangular wave. Hence, this is also called as a free running multivibrator or oscillator. It is going to generate square waves. Hence, it is a oscillator or free running multivibrator. Whereas a monostable multivibrator will need an external trigger input to make the output change from stable to semi or quasi-stable state. Hence, this is also called as a one shot, because with one trigger input, it will shoot from stable to quasi-stable. And after that, from quasi-stable to stable, it will come back on its own. No need of trigger. So a trigger input like this or like this is needed. This duration is very, very small. This duration will be very, very small. And whereas in bistable, you see two trigger inputs are applied. One trigger to change from zero to one state, and another trigger to change from one to zero state. because both the states are stable states, which means to say the output will continue to permanently remain in that state unless and until you apply an external trigger to make it change the state. I think we'll stop with this here, and we will continue with analysis of monostable and astable multivibrator in our next class. So the summary of today's class is, we just tried to understand the internal block diagram and working of the 555 timer IC. In the next class, we will try to analyze monostable and astable multivibrator.